morning and welcome to the Berks County Board of Commissioners meeting for April the 13th. We'll begin with a moment of silence followed by a pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We're going to begin this morning with a special presentation. We have Rick Perriandi, the second ever president of Crime Alert Berks County, and Barry Rohrbach, the first president of Crime Alert. And they're here to present a report of activities for Crime Alert Berks County. And I believe our district attorney, who I know is here, will be presenting a check. So I'll recognize Rick and Barry, and then you can call up the DA when you're ready for your money.
Would you like to come over there?
Sure. Why don't you come right over there? Yeah.
If you're giving us money, you can come over here.
That's right. You can sit. We'll move one of the other people up here.
Good morning, commissioners.
Good morning.
It's another pleasure to be here. This may be my last. You never know. But it's been a pleasure for 18 plus years to come to this committee, commissioners, and I remember many years ago coming before this board, and Mark Scott was the commissioner then, one of the commissioners then, and I think he made the motion to give us our first money from the commission. Maybe Mark wants to talk about that sometime. It's an interesting time.
It was.
But
it's always a big thing and interesting when Mark Scott spends money.
But I think even increased it after.
That's even more amazing.
Yeah, I recall it very well. I made a motion, I think, to give you, was it $2,000?
Yeah.
And there was some spirited debate. One of my colleagues made a rather impassioned argument that the program wouldn't work or was whatever. And so I withdrew my motion and made a new motion to give him $3,000.
That's right.
Which passed.
That's right.
So that was funny.
Yeah, it's been a great time. We're one of the Crime Stoppers program in Pennsylvania, and it's unfortunate that Pennsylvania, the state, doesn't see fit to honor this organization for the job that they have done. You, the commissioners, know the local politicians have treated us very well over the years, and it like I said, it's just a shame that that they don't see fit to recognize what we have done as far as a job. But that's neither here nor there. We're here today to talk about Crime Alert, and this is like the past and the future. Mm-hmm. I'm the past and Rick Perriandi's the future. And John Adams, yeah, John sitting back. John, why don't you come up while you have that check in hand?
I was going to say John.
And John,
the question is, do you have the check? Because if you don't have the check, I don't want you up there.
Well, I'm surprised you don't carry a mounted camera on your side.
A GoPro.
John always tells us that he gives us, he takes us money from the bad guys and gives it to the good guys, which is us. And he's been doing this for many, many years, ever since he's been a district attorney. And also, he does something else. Every year, we're up to about 70% now of the municipalities in Berks County. Mm-hmm. And that's through the efforts of John here. He sends a letter out to them, and we've
gotten a lot of new people every year. Unfortunately, we have some municipalities that they do not have police, their own police department, so they use state police. And unfortunately, we haven't been able to get all of those, but we're working on it. And what John does, he offers them incentive. If they give us so much, he'll match that. And so that's how we're up to about 70%. So, John, I guess we'll let you go now, and then we'll let Rick finish up here.
All right. Well, again, it's my pleasure to... and now that Bob Patrizio has left the room, it's me.
I think he ran to get something just for this.
I'm sure he did. I'm sure he's going to get his own cell phone camera and he's going to record this. But again, it's my pleasure to present this check to Crime Alert for their continued efforts to assist law enforcement in Berks County. They do a great job. And more and more, when we are trying to solve some crimes or get information, Crime Alert and the fact that people can remain anonymous and get paid for their tips is just imperative to our mission to solve crime and to our mission to prevent crime in our community. So I have a check here in the amount of $15,000 payable to Crime Alert, and that will hopefully help them to assist in their efforts to help law enforcement. And again, this money, the monies that we are donating to Crime Alert are from our drug forfeiture fund. I am certain that we will continue with our efforts continue to support Crime Alert in years to come. We had a very fruitful recovery of monies recently, and this will ensure our support of Crime Alert will continue. Now that Bob's back, we're not going to talk any more about
money.
Thank you.
Thanks, John.
Thank you, John, and thank you to the commissioners for your support over the many, many years. As Barry mentioned, with Mark's support originally, we're in our 19th year. So the county commissioners have been with us throughout this entire period supporting what we do. And you know, it's a cliche to say you can't replace somebody, but in this case, I think it's an accurate statement. You can't replace Barry Rohrbach. So people have asked me what it's going to be like being president of Crime Alert Berks, and how do you replace somebody like Barry? And I tell them, as I said, it's a cliche that when you say you can't, but you can't. So you just sort of try to do your own, use your own abilities to lead an organization like this, which has been quite successful. We're number one in the state for the past 14, 15 years in amount of money paid out in rewards. We, over the 19 years that we've been in existence, we've averaged 35 reward payments per year. Reward payment for us is we pay it on a tip if it leads to an arrest. And the last few years, we've really been into the low 40s because our average early in our tenure was not quite as high. We might have only paid out like two dozen a year or so in that period of time. So lately we've been increasing, and our goal has been for the past few years and continues to be to reach that 50 to 52 mark. We'd like to get to where we pay at least one tip once, or have one successful tip and pay out one award every week. So that's our goal. We've not met that yet, but we do average about $1,000 per reward payment. Our budget is based on really two areas. Reward payments is number one, and marketing and advertising is number two. So when you see the billboards and the signs around Berks County publicizing Crime Alert, that's what we spend our money on. We have a 42-member board, all of whom are volunteers. No one associated with the board for Crime Alert is compensated. We do have a few consultants that we pay for fundraising and for and to give us some advice relative to advertising and obviously to set up our advertising and our billboards and things like that. But those are the only consultants that are paid outside of our normal budget. So we like to always reiterate that so that the county commissioners, the district attorney, the citizens of Berks County recognize that the money that they are donating or providing to Crime Alert Berks County is going for the purpose of which we have publicized, which is to pay anonymous tips for or rewards for anonymous tips that lead to an arrest in Berks County. If the commissioners have any questions, I'd be glad to try to answer them.
I think from the standpoint of the county, it's money well spent that we provide to Crime Alert every year, and it's money well spent for solving crimes.
Thank you, Kevin. Thank you, Christian. Thank you, Mark. Appreciate your support over the years.
My pleasure.
Appreciate it. Thank you, Rick, for stepping up and filling some giant shoes, but I know you'll do a great job. You and your brother, I think, have been there almost since day one as well.
Yeah, well, my brother has been the treasurer
right.
since the beginning. I was still active with the state police when Barry started it, so an active police officer can only serve on the advisory board, mm-hmm. which I did, and then when I retired from the state police, I went on to our main board, and I've been there for the past 10 years, and then Barry decided that he was no longer going to run for president, so I stepped in and took over, so we'll see. I think everything should go pretty well.
Great. It would be nice if everyone who commits a crime could be brought to justice, but that doesn't always happen. I don't know what the ratio of solved to unsolved crimes is, but anything that can improve that ratio is money well spent as far as I'm concerned. And it's always surprising to me how the commission of crime can touch a person's life and you don't expect it. I'll just briefly tell you that many years ago, I think it was about 12 to 15 years ago, I'd injured my shoulder, and I was referred to a rehab center over by the Reading Hospital, and I went there for the process involved the application of some pad that had tingling electrical surges or whatever it was in it, and they would apply it to my shoulder for a certain period of time. And this, I went to these rehab sessions maybe a half dozen times, something like that. And there was a young man there who was probably in his 20s working in this rehab center, and he applied this thing to my shoulder and had a very nice, you know, bedside manner, knew exactly what he was doing. And I didn't even really know his name. And I guess a few months later, I read in the paper and I saw a picture of this very person who had been killed. And I'd been out, I guess, he lived in Reading with his parents. I think he was at a bar or something, must have mixed it up with the wrong people, returned home, fell asleep on the couch in the living room of his house downstairs. Somebody went through the door which he had left ajar, and shot him dead on the couch. I believe the man's last name was Matusik. I don't believe that crime, to my knowledge, has ever been solved. I asked, from time to time, I'll ask the DA or somebody else, and I'm not asking you to go into that, but it's something that you just don't expect to be, you know, involved tangentially with someone who's a victim of crime to that degree, and it happened to me. So anything to be done to, you know, solve those crimes, and I hope that one in particular is money well spent.
And what we do, Mark, we have a matrix that allows us to be fair in our payment of any of our awards, and it's based upon the type of crime, whether it's a crime against a person or crime against property, the number of crimes that might be solved by a tip, the number of individuals that might be arrested as a result of a tip. So we follow that in order to determine what we would pay out in any given crime. But for a homicide, we pay up to $10,000.
Very good.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you. Thank you
Joe.
Very much.
Okay. Are there any additions or corrections for the April 6, 2017 Commissioner Meeting Minutes? Hearing none, the minutes will stand approved as presented. For the record, we did have an executive session on Monday. I dealt with personnel and litigation and real estate. Is there any public comment on specific agenda items? Hearing none, we will move into the agenda under authorizing budget department. There's one item, adopt a resolution authorizing 2016 budget transfers in the amount of $59,527, 2016 appropriations in the amount of $488,505, 2017 budget transfers in the amount of $34,583, and 2017 appropriations in the amount of negative $42,742 per listing dated April the 10th, 2017. Our CFO, Bob, why don't you just briefly explain the negative? We rarely have a negative number. Let people know what that's about.
I'm happy to do so. As you know, commissioners, we have fiscal year funding for most of our human service programs, including the MHDD program, so July 1 of one fiscal year to June 30. So it covers two different calendar years for our budget, and the volume of activity in MHDD through the first 6 months of that fiscal year, July 1, December 31 of 16. The last 6 months of our calendar year was higher than what we had anticipated when we did the budget. So what we have done is we had to take funding out of the first 6 months of this year, still part of their annual allocation, and move it back to 16.
Okay.
But to make sure we didn't overspend the program, we negatively appropriate this in 17's calendar year to make sure we don't go over the allocation.
Okay. Very good. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Facilities, we have one item, adopt a resolution authorizing a final project completion payment to Lower Alsace Township in the amount of $3,906.25. This is reimbursement from County Liquid Fuels allocation for the township's project to repair and relocate guide rail on Angora Road. Under adult probation, we have one item. We rarely have Dan in our presence. So Dan, why don't you come up to the microphone, introduce yourself, and explain the item here under probation.
Morning, commissioners.
Good morning.
Dan Hyde, adult probation and parole, subbing in for Chief Bob Williams today. The item on the agenda today is a grant received from PCCD for $38,387. The grant is designed to improve our implementation of evidence-based practices in adult probation and parole. The money must be spent by June 30th, and we think we have a pretty good cause for spending this money here. The money's been allocated to the Carey Group for supervisor training for $12,425 total. Part of that is supervisor's briefcase training. These trainings will assist our supervisors in coaching, mentoring, and delivering quality assurance to our frontline officers on a regular basis. In addition to that, we've spent $25,962 to NCTI, National Curriculum and Training Institute, for COG groups that we're going to deliver to the offenders, working with our offenders on life skills, alcohol stabilization, driving, DUI, and shoplifting. So I think it's a good grant and a good opportunity.
Good. Thank you, Dan. Any questions?
Thank you.
Thank you. We have three items listed. Item A, adopt a authorizing execution of the report and certification on hazardous material emergency response preparedness to the Pennsylvania Emergency Management Agency. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing execution of engineering service agreement between the County of Berks and Skelly and Loy Engineering, and this is for engineering environmental consulting. This provides professional planning services to update the county's 2013 hazard vulnerability assessment and mitigation plan. It is a not to exceed amount of $65,025. Item C, adopt a resolution authorizing execution of the release and indemnity agreement with the borough of Kutztown, releasing the County of Berks from liability that may be incurred by the county due to dispatching emergency medical services unit as directed by the municipality. There's one item, two items actually listed under Commissioners. Item A, adopt a resolution authorizing execution of a letter from the Board of Commissioners to the Pennsylvania Commission on Crime and Delinquency, supporting their proposal submission to the United States Department of Justice for the planning and implementation of comprehensive strategies in response to the growing opioid epidemic. And then item B, adopt a resolution authorizing and approving the law firm Norris McLaughlin and Marcus to provide additional legal services as assigned by the county solicitor at the current rate of $225 per hour. Item two, a motion authorizing the chair of the board to execute contract agreements and amendments as furnished by the contract coordinator per attached listing dated April the 11th of 2017. There are a total of 9 contracts, 3 of them with the Area Agency on Aging, 3 with Children and Youth Services, 1 with the Berks County Jail, 1 with Berkshein Nursing and Rehabilitation, and 1 with juvenile probation. And then finally, a motion to ratify and confirm payments as set forth on the Comptroller's Office voucher listing dated April the 11th for the week ending April the 12th, and the payment of electronic transfers and employee payroll. That was actually signed last week so that the Comptroller's Office could execute those checks, I believe, yesterday.
That's correct.
Because of the holiday tomorrow. So that completes our agenda.
Motion to approve the agenda as presented.
Second to the motion.
The motion's been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The motion is carried. Before we go into our reports, I see Dave is here from the Reading Eagle. Just in case you didn't know, Dave, the front table is for the reporters. We like the reporters to be up front where we can keep an eye on them. Now, we did expect that Liam would be here on his last day, so there is a cake up front. I didn't want you to think that each week when you get here, there's going to be a cake. We were celebrating Liam's term of service here with the county. I don't want to say we're celebrating his departure. We don't know who we're going to get in his place. Are you his replacement?
I don't know.
We could do a lot worse, Dave.
Well, thank you.
So.
Oh, that's not the endorsement.
They're probably drawing straws now at the Eagle.
Right? Yeah, they're drawing straws. Who wants to deal with these guys?
So we have two options. Do we give you the cake to take back to Liam, or do we just celebrate the fact that it would have been Liam's last day here, so we divide
it
amongst ourselves?
We're probably
going to
have a cake later at the office.
We'll eat it here.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll line up here.
But
thank you.
Seriously, Liam has done a great job. He is one of the reporters that I never worried about what I told him, whether or not he'd get it right. He always was truthful, and he always came back. If he didn't understand something, had a question, he would ask to talk to me or talk to one of our department heads, and that's what a reporter is supposed to do. Get the facts, present the facts in an interesting but factual manner, and let the reader decide what is actually taking place. I know there's an editorial role for the paper. I'm not talking about that. But Liam was very good. He's going on to the Pennsylvania Farm Bureau. And I think I read his article this morning. I'll bet you there'll be some Berks County stories at some point that'll be able to highlight. Berks County, I believe, has the highest county membership for the Pennsylvania Farm Bureau. So there'll be some Berks County stories that he'll be sharing in his role with marketing PR, I believe, with Pennsylvania Farm Bureau, but he will be missed.
Sure, Liam certainly got it right away. I mean, you didn't have to repeat yourself more than once to Liam. He got it right away. And I just think he did a phenomenal job with the transportation issues and good things about what's taking place here in Berks County. He did a great job of getting that word out and very accurately to people. So I'm going to miss that, not just having him here at commissioners' meetings, but his overall understanding of the transportation issues here in Berks County.
But you are welcome, and you're welcome to stay with us, so. With that, we'll transfer over to Dennis Adams. Dennis has the treasurer's report.
I'd like to ditto on Liam. I think he was really a good guy to work with, and enjoyed it. So. Today we have an opening balance of $136,841,686. $1.61, leaving us with a balance today of $129,849,057.92.
And our county controller, Sandy Graffius, with the controller's report.
Good morning.
Good morning.
General accounts payable $2,354,875. We had wire transfers of $2,817,225. We had no payroll, for a grand total of $5,172,100.64.
And with that, we'll turn to Commissioner Barnhart for Commissioner's reports.
Okay. You wanted to skip Bob and Ron right away, right? That's okay if you want to do that.
That's a good point. Okay. Minor detail. Yeah. CFO, Bob Patrizio with the agenda for this afternoon.
Right off the agenda.
Budget operations meeting.
Good morning. We do have a budget meeting this afternoon, and it does start at 2:30, not 2 o'clock. And we have some select items we'd like to show you with respect to the 2018-2021 forecast, information you have not seen. And also, we wanted to spend about 15 minutes and just talk about our budget kickoff meeting, which is in two Thursdays from now, just to canvass the board with some points of emphasis that the board feels we might want to make at that meeting. And if I might add, I just want to let the board know, we did lock in some more of our electric rate for 2018. We did another 25% hedge. I'll have just a takeaway at the end of the budget meeting today, but that was obviously favorable for us. And we also locked in an additional 50% of our consumption in terms of the natural gas rate for 18 and 19. So for natural gas, we now have 100% of our consumption, our pricing hedged for 18 and 19, and the savings on that over the 16 actual for each one of those years is $170,000. So that's a really nice move on our part. And obviously that came with the recommendation of Utilitech, whom we work very closely with.
So. Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ron Seaman for the administrator's report.
Thank you. A couple of notes. I do want to also congratulate Liam on the fine job he's done here. I first had the privilege of meeting and working with him when I served on the BARDA Authority Board, and especially through the transition period where we merged with Red Rose and created probably a model for the rest of the Commonwealth to look at. And his portrayal of that whole period of time. Interestingly enough, I responded to his email yesterday when he announced his departure, congratulating him on the work he's done, and also lamenting the fact that a fellow gourmand was going to be leaving, because we both prided ourselves in seeking out the best selection of such delicacies as ice cream and so forth. And he indicated to me that a part of his new journey will be working on a publication that does delve in food sources and so forth. So I'm looking forward to seeing some of those articles as well. The last thing I'd just like to comment on is to ask that maybe everybody reflect on the world situation that we've been facing over the last couple weeks, sending out to those of the Jewish faith the best of the Passover season, and those of the Christian persuasion, this being Holy Week, and maybe ask that each of us just reflect for a moment and look within ourselves and see if we can't start making this world a better place, beginning with each of us. So.
We'll turn to Commissioner Barnhart for your report.
I'm still reflecting. I have to follow Ron on that one. So.
With the lack of hair, you reflect a lot.
Okay. He'll be here all week. Going back to the commissioner's item, I want to thank the commissioners for supporting the request for a grant consideration for what is going to be a grant request of $200,000. We were, COCA, Council on Chemical Abuse in the County, was contacted last week by the Technical Assistance Center, University of Pittsburgh, who has been helping us along with our opioids coalition. We are one of only three counties in Pennsylvania who were selected to apply for this grant, and it's really a sustainability grant to continue with public outreach and education, to support the warm handoff, which is taking place at the Reading Health System, and take back plans and things of that nature. So it's a sustainability grant where things are already taking place. We'll continue to provide those services. This does not require any staffing. It's going to use the complement of staff that we already have at COCA. And I want to, again, compliment the volunteers on the Opioids Coalition. I think we're close to about 50 members. We have five subcommittees, and everyone's actively engaged on a monthly basis, meeting and going through all the data and coming up with some really great programs to help us to turn the tide on the opioids overdose. And we have a really succinct mission statement: stop overdoses. It didn't take us long to come up with that. So it's really tragic. We were up at Virginville Grange on Friday night for a legislative event, and Dennis Hess, our coroner, I think said it best. Last year, or the year before, we had 60 overdose deaths. This year was 120. It's going to be probably projected to be 135, 140 this year. And but for Narcan, the drug that brings people back from overdoses, he said that number would easily be doubled going into this year. So we have a tough road ahead of us, but we're losing some of the best and brightest people in our community to overdose. And it's a brain disease, as we've been told countless times by Council on Chemical Abuse. We have to recognize what it is, and we have to identify it and work on it as a community. So I want to thank the commissioners for their support on that. Yesterday, I was pleased to go down to Southwest Philadelphia to be part of a contingent to discuss with the South Central Leadership Council of the House of Representatives Democratic Caucus with Representative McClinton. There was about 14 to 18 state representatives who came to this hearing. We were asked by the County Commissioners Association, Maureen Barden, who is a fellow who provides support to CCAP and myself, to speak about pretrial and bail procedure reform as it takes place here in Berks County as well as across the Commonwealth. And I want to commend Maureen for her outstanding job of dealing with this issue to this committee, as well as Nikki Schnabel, one of our co-directors of Berks Connections Pretrial Service. They did a phenomenal job and really put that information out there. Hopefully this is going to get legs in the House of Representatives and really continue to look at what, as Commissioner Leinbach finds out at NACO meetings, pretrial and bail reform, especially bail reform in other states, is light years ahead of what's going on here in Pennsylvania. I think we're pretty darn good with pretrial, especially we're outstanding here in Berks County, but I think we're lagging behind other states on being proactive about bail procedure. So hopefully that will work its way through the chambers of Harrisburg after they solve their budget issues. Just a quick reminder, next Thursday, so put it on your calendar, is our last and final public presentation of the Mount Penn Preserve final plan. It will be at Stokesay between 7 and 9 p.m. on Thursday, April 20th, so it's open to the public. Please come out and see what ideas have been provided to us by over 550 people who filled out the online survey, and we had close to 200 people come out to our four public meetings. So some good ideas, some ideas we know are easily achievable, and some that are not so highly easily achievable, but we want to put them out there for public consumption. So once again, as Ron reminded us, let's all enjoy with our family and friends Easter and Passover. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Scott.
I have nothing further. Thank you.
A couple items very quickly. I also want to wish our Jewish friends a very blessed Passover, and Christians that are celebrating Good Friday and Easter, wishing them a very blessed holiday as well. One note, I believe both Commissioner and I were on a CCAP conference call this morning talking about the budget as it's been proposed in Harrisburg, in particular, the budget coming out of the legislature. There will be more on this, but the core message that people need to be aware of, the cuts proposed in human services, some people think the cuts are in welfare, but they are further cuts to human services that are being provided by counties and, in most cases, mandated that they be provided by counties. So in essence, these are not cost savings by the legislature. This is a cost shift from state taxes to county property tax. There will be more information coming out with real specifics on these, but this has been going on year after year. It happened in the Rendell years, it happened in the Corbett years, and it's happening again, where we get cuts in children and youth services, but we're expected and in fact required to continue the same level of service. And in the case of CYS, we've had additional laws put into place, commonly known as the Sandusky laws, that have dramatically increased our workload and our costs, and yet the legislature feels that it's necessary to continue to cut. A suggestion was made this morning, and I actually was very impressed with it. It came from one of our Democratic colleagues, George Hartwick, and he suggested that, yes, there is an opportunity for savings, even at the county level, and CCAP would love to sit down with the legislature and talk about some of the savings that could be realized if they understood some of the regulatory issues that they have imposed on counties, or some of the procedures they've imposed on counties that do not save money, they cost taxpayers money. I'm hopeful that that's something CCAP might be able to act on, and the legislature and the administration but would be willing to listen. Finally, this afternoon, I will be offering testimony before a Senate subcommittee holding hearings across the Commonwealth, actually I think in three locations, Pittsburgh, Philadelphia, and Reading, dealing with the proposed consolidation of four human service departments into one. I'm not going to share my full testimony, but it comes in two parts. The first part I'll be sharing are 10 key principles that the County Commissioners Association believes need to be implemented if the consolidation goes forward. CCAP has not taken a position for or against the consolidation. The concern, though, is if it does go forward, these issues have to be addressed. And then I will be commenting as a Berks County Commissioner, not on behalf of my colleagues, but my opinion. And I'm making the point that I believe it's possible to have a merger that's just simply too big. I highlighted this information before. The new organization will have 18,000 employees, a $40 billion budget, and I've done some research. If this new DHSS, Department of Health and Human Services, was a state, it would have the 16th largest budget in the United States. $40 billion is larger than the Commonwealth budget at about $31.5 billion, and the reason it's larger is because it also incorporates federal dollars that it's authorized to spend. And my second point is there are other ways to address the inefficiency and the communication issues between these departments that don't necessarily require a merger into this enormous organization. So I do want to make one other comment. When I last talked about this, I referenced the CCAP spring conference, and specifically Dennis Marion, who worked for the drug and alcohol side of human services at the state level. He's a former chief clerk in Cumberland County for many years. I did not realize that that morning he died. I mean, I was literally in his workshop that Monday afternoon, and he went in for a procedure, I believe that was a Thursday morning, and never came out of the procedure. So I really sincerely wish condolences to his family and friends, and he had a lot of friends. He, while I disagreed with him on this issue, he was very well respected in the County Commissioners Association through his work at the county level, but also his work in human services. That's all that I have. Is there any public comment on any specific items or role officer? Yes, Sandy.
I know I mentioned this before, April 29th, but there's going to be a 5K run starting at West Reading Playground. It's going to be run by children and youth, and the theme is No Excuse for Abuse. We had the people on my controller's TV show, and we talked about the fact that I would stand by the side and cheer people on, and they showed up the next day with a cowbell for me to ring. And so that night I went to a dinner, and I was speaking to Dunn Mull, who has B&G Glass, and he has agreed to wear a cow uniform by the side of the road so that we can cheer the people on. And I really am trying to get people to sign up to do the 5K. It costs $15, and for your $15, you get a T-shirt. This is not a fundraiser. This is a sensitivity awareness raiser.
Very good. Thank you. Any public comment?
Motion to adjourn.
Meeting is adjourned.